Welcome to Your College Bound Kid,
a podcast for parents, college counselors, students, and anyone who wants a weekly deep dive into the world of college admissions.
My name is Dave. I'm a parent of a daughter in college, and we live in Chicago, Illinois.
I'm Lisa, and I'm a clinical psychologist and college counselor. I have a daughter in college, a daughter in high school, and a son in middle school. After 30 years in Chicago, we recently moved to North Carolina.
My name is Mark. I'm a college coach in Atlanta and the parent of two daughters, Karis, a graduate of Davidson College, and she is the founder of the Spanish tutoring company, SpanishHelpToday.com. And Joy is a graduate of the University of Georgia, and she is getting her master's degree at North Carolina State University.
Good morning, friends. After 20 days in Ohio, Florida, South Carolina, Florida, back to South Carolina again, and then finally back to Metro Atlanta. I love to travel, but someone was very prescient when they coined the phrase home sweet home. So I've been back now for 3 days, and I'm back here until I go on the road for another week, June 5th through June 9th, visiting 7 or 8 schools in Tennessee, mostly in the greater Nashville, Knoxville, that area. So I'll be sure to report back on some of those schools when I get a chance to visit. But, you know, we've visited so many schools. We got a lot of spotlights to share with you coming up here. Lisa and I got out to spend about 3 to 4 hours on High Point's campus, also on Elon's campus. I did an extended Furman University visit, and I'd hope to have details on USC, that's the Columbia, South Carolina one, and Clemson, and Wofford, and Flagler, but most of those ended up just involving me driving around campus, so not enough for spotlight for them. Okay, before we dive in today, I want to say a word about you, our listening family. And that's my specific name, not for every listener. It's for our listeners who never miss an episode. You inspire me. You inspire all 7 of our co-hosts. Lisa, Dave, Susan, Linda, Vince, Julia, and then Sylvie and Kevin. You inspire us by tuning in every week. You know, I did a session yesterday with a client from Hawaii who never misses an episode, and started out right away. She said, "Are you finally back?" And I said, I knew she was up to date on all episodes because I had been reporting to you guys when I was in Jacksonville or Winston-Salem or Raleigh or who knows where else. And it just fired me up. So thank you for the inspiration. One reason why I sound so happy when we record is because I'm talking with our listening family and you guys inspire me. I want to also say a word about the mission and the motto of Your College Bound Kid. I don't mention it that often, but it's really important, and just saying it inspires me. Our motto and our mission is to make college knowledge available to all. To make college knowledge available to all. This is why we crank out 3 hours of content a week. 2 hours on Thursdays, another hour on Monday. That's why we have a team of 7 co-hosts and another support team of 9. And you mostly get that information ingested through the podcast, but there are a few other ways we attempt to live out our mission of trying to make college knowledge available to all. Our website, yourcollegeboundkid.com, has content you don't get if you're only using an app. For example, 141 interviews in their entirety, not having to do a part one, part two, part three, transcripts of all of our podcasts, 128 college spotlights, photos of all of our interviewees, bios on all of our 7 co-hosts and our 9 other volunteers and our contractors who help produce an episode. I encourage you to go read those bios. You know, you'll learn a little bit about who's involved in the production of an episode. All of our recommended books, I think we're close to 70. I haven't even counted recently. All of our recommended websites since inception, they're all up there. And pretty soon you're going to see a whole new website layout, but I'll share more of that later. But there are 2 other resources I really want to highlight. Our blog, which you'll find on yourcollegeboundkid.com. We have around 35 articles, and it's new. We haven't had our blog up that long. And I have to shout out Linda, who's taken a real lead in both our blog and our second thing, which is our newsletter, YCBK Plus. This is our monthly newsletter, and we have a new newsletter going out this Wednesday. So if you just go to yourcollegeboundkid.com and sign up for our newsletter, it's got really great content. I really believe if you like our podcast, you're really going to like our newsletter. Just to let you know a couple of things that you'll get in the May edition of YCBK Plus, amongst others. But there's a great article on pros and cons of a co-op program. What is a co-op program? What's the history of a co-op program? What are the leading schools for co-op programs? That's a really, really helpful article, similar to our podcast, just in written form. Another great article is on 200 plus colleges that are still accepting new applications right now. Where do you find them? What are 7 different ways you can search for these colleges? So once again, just go to yourcollegeboundkid.com. You'll see an opportunity right there to sign up for YCBK Plus. And remember, friends, knowledge is power. So this Wednesday, it'll be delivered right into your email box. Speaking of Linda and Lisa, I thought they did a really good job talking about how to transition from high school to college. And one of our listeners wanted to know how much she appreciated that interview. So listen to what she sent in to us about that interview that Lisa and Linda did the last 2 Mondays.
Hi, I was listening to episode 324, and I just really, really appreciated the interview that Lisa did with Linda about the transition to college and the experience of parents. I have a freshman at UCLA who did exactly what Linda and Lisa were describing in terms of how children separate. And I don't think parents are prepared enough for that. So it really validated our experience and it made me hopeful. And he has communicated more now, but it is a real shock. And I do believe that we need to talk about that more because as parents, we are often not prepared for that. So thanks to Lisa and Linda for the insight and the validation. Much, much, much appreciated. And this is Danielle Castillo. I am a avid listener of the show. Thanks to all. And thank you, Mark, for the podcast. It has been incredibly insightful for the past 2 years that I've listened to it.
Okay, friends, for today's episode, so if you listen very attentively at the end of Thursday's episode, I planned on talking to you about early action and sharing a few observations about early action. I'm calling an audible. I'll come back to that. I'm tabling it. I'll return later because of something that happened to me this week. Now, one thing I love about my job is I'm always learning. I'm always growing. Steven Antonoff got it right when he wrote his book on college counselors, and he entitled it A Student of Colleges. What a great name. That's what we are. And some of you are probably thinking, well, of course you're learning every day. You get to travel all around the country and get flown into all these colleges. And you get to meet with admission officers every week and interview them. Of course you're learning and growing. And while that is true, one of the main ways I learn and grow is from the students and parents I interact with every day. They're always teaching me something, just like our podcast listeners are always teaching me something. But I'm recording this on Sunday. I like to do the Monday episodes just the day before, just in case there's something that really breaks that I need to share. Unfortunately, Nemanja is patient enough with me to do all of the editorial work same day and get it out to you by midnight. But I want to share a story that is from a 10th grader, and I learned this on Friday, and it really, really inspired me. And it's about how this 10th grader had 8 to 10 prominent research opportunities with elite universities, and I want to share her story with you. Because not only is it inspirational, but it's also instructional. In other words, you can get inspired, but you can also learn from what she did if that's something that might be appropriate for your student. And we're going to start a brand new interview. It's a three-parter. It's with David Marcus, author of the book Acceptance and other books. I think you're going to really like that as well. And I'll get to more about that later. But let me start with the student that inspired me this week, who I believe can inspire you. Before I proceed, though, I don't want you to think that I talk to a student or a parent and then I come on the mic and blab about all their personal business and spread it all across the globe. I discussed in detail with this student's dad what parts of their story they were comfortable with me sharing on the podcast and what parts we want to keep private. So everything I share here has been approved by the student's parent. Okay. So this student's dad is someone who I've been meeting with for 4 years now. We started at the end of sixth grade, and we don't meet all the time, because I know some of you are thinking, sixth grade, is that really when you're supposed to start the college process? No. Meets with me about twice a year. He writes down a bunch of questions, and when he gets them, he just schedules a session. But now his daughter's finishing up 10th, so yeah, we've been doing this since the end of 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, and now the end of 10th. The last 4 years, a couple times a year. And I just meet with the dad. We do sessions. You're like, well, what do you guys talk about? We talk about a lot of things. Like I said, I'll answer his series of questions he'll keep over the course of 6 months. And it's not exactly 6 months. He might have enough questions after 4 months and schedule it. Then he might go 7 or 8 months. But it's on average about twice a year. And we're talking about, in addition to answering his questions, we're talking about things like what curriculum choices should his daughter make. Like, he lays out all the scenarios for me. We go over all different things related to extracurriculars. We talk about summer plans and just a wide assortment of things. Different colleges might have specific questions about. But his daughter's always driving this process. It's not some ambitious dad with ambition run amok. He's always bringing to me his daughter's interests, her talents, her strengths, her gifts, and just trying to best figure out how to cultivate them to maximize her opportunities and just understand how the sausage is made and how this process works. So it's about a year ago, really toward the end of 9th, his dad said something that really got me excited. He said, I don't know where this is coming from, but all of a sudden, my daughter's developing this intense interest in molecular biology, specifically genetics. And she can't get enough of it. And his dad would say, is this unusual? Like, do other kids do this? Like, where is this coming from? And I immediately identified, this is passion. And passion can be translated into a career. Next thing you know, she takes an edX genetics class, and that passion's just growing, growing, growing. And it's motivated not by a desire to get into some elite college, but just an insatiable love to learn. I don't even know if the daughter's even thought of how this might be related to the college process. But this is where it really gets interesting. And this is where I said, okay, I'm tabling what I was going to say about APs. I'm pulling an audible and I'm sharing this with our listeners. Because, like I said, it inspired me. And I think it inspired you as well. So literally, the information I'm sharing with you is not even 48 hours old. So I'm recording this at 1 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time on Sunday. And we did our session, it was around, you know, around this time Friday, 48 hours ago. And before I dive into that, I want to say something. So about a year and a half, 2 years ago, I interviewed Matt McGann, one of my favorite people in admissions, by the way. Matt's the director of admissions at Amherst College. And when I interviewed Matt, you're like, where is he going with this? Like, I'll land the plane, I hope, and bring it back. The topic was how to get a research opportunity as a high school student. That's what Matt and I talked about. We also talked about the difference between research opportunities at a liberal arts school, a place like Amherst, and a national university. Matt had been at MIT, had run that office, and was there for almost 20 years. So he was talking about the difference in research opportunities at a national university versus a liberal arts college. And I share that because a lot of times people just come to our podcast and they just start listening, moving forward. They don't realize like the reservoir of 500 hours of content we have at Your College Bound Kid. And if you're interested in research, I would encourage you to go back and listen to the Matt McGannart interview. You can just go to yourcollegeboundkid.com and just put the word Matt, M-A-T-T, into the search bar. I love Matt. I think he's fantastic. But enough about Matt. Let's talk about what this student did to get her research opportunity, because the thing she did, there's even more detail here on how to actually get the opportunity than what Matt and I talked about. So the student started with a simple Google search. Who's doing cutting edge reading research in genetics on college campuses? So she immediately was able to identify some of the cutting edge research in genetics, in particular in the areas of genetics she was interested in, and what leading universities this was happening on. She did more research. She got the names of the lead professors and the team doing the research, including the grad assistants working on them. She then read the research abstracts and other papers that the researchers had done. She looked up their email addresses and she began reaching out. You know, I was talking to her dad. I said, did she use LinkedIn in a network? And dad said, I don't even know if she knows what LinkedIn is. It was really funny. It was just a basic Google search. And then she reached out with a simple introductory email. And she let the researchers know a little bit about who she was. I'm in 10th grade. This is the state that I live in. And I'm really interested in, you know, genetics and the specific type of genetics. She talked about the books that she'd read. She talked about the online course she took. And she talked about how much she enjoyed reading their research. She then said she would love to be able to be part of an exciting research opportunity in a specific area of genetics that she's really drawn to. And she asked for what advice they would have for her to get a research opportunity. She thanked them in advance for their advice and simple introductory email. Now, sometimes she encountered non-responsiveness. Not everybody responded. She learned she actually had more success reaching out to the grad assistants, who were secondary players, than sometimes with the tenured professors, although that was mixed. She also heard from the tenured professors. Well, what happened? What did they say? Did it work? Let me jump right to the bottom line. Many of them responded and said, I think we allow some high school researchers to join our projects. Let me look into the process and get back to you. What's the upshot? She had 8 to 10 offers as a 10th grader to do research at the most elite universities in the country in her specific area of interest. Let me repeat that. She had 8 to 10 offers to do research as a high school 10th grader from the most elite universities in the country. She selected one, an opportunity that many people think a 10th grader would never get. Now, I know what many of you are thinking. Stuck. Is it really fair to talk about some unicorn, some baby Einstein, some child genius, and hold it out to us as a model? Really? Are you serious? Well, let me share a few things about this student. Once again, I've been meeting for 4 years with her dad a couple times a year. She does not have straight A's. She's not going to get perfect test scores. She's in the regular track in some subjects and not in the advanced track, because there's some subjects it just wouldn't be in her best interest to be in the advanced track. She'd be unlikely to get a really high grade. It wouldn't be good for her mental health or her work-life balance. She's a regular kid who found a passion. So what are the takeaways I'd like for you to learn from this? When you discover a passion, read widely. Look for additional opportunities, like the edX class the student took. Be proactive. Do research. Do research. Find the people doing research projects that appeal to you. Read their materials. Understand it's a compliment to read their materials. I'm always complimented when someone says I've never missed an episode when I first meet them. I'm like, wow, 500 hours. I'm impressed. And they also feel like you understand them when you put some time in to get to know their materials. And they're excited about their project. It's like their baby. All of a sudden, someone's also excited in their research. Remember, most people go into education to help others and make a difference. So you see some young 10th grader, and you probably know I wasn't thinking about this stuff at that age. I might want to meet this person. And you compliment them in a genuine way, no puffery. Then you're explicit with your request. I'm looking for a research opportunity. And then don't be afraid to ask for help. A lot of people, like I said, would love to help a student like this, who approaches them with dignity and politeness and respect, and not in an overbearing way. Now, here's another takeaway I want you to take from this. This is really, 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 really important. I don't want you to go to your student and say, you have to do research. I learned about this great opportunity. Please don't do that. I have two great kids. I'm proud of them. They've done very well in school. They both went to selective schools and did well. Neither one of them had the passion to do this as 10th graders. And so it would have been a terrible idea if I would have approached them and told them this is what they need to do. But here's what else I want to tell you. There are a lot of people out here peddling research opportunities for high school kids that start at $15,000 and $25,000 is not uncommon. And I've looked at those opportunities, and those students are not getting the opportunity this student is getting just by putting in some sweat equity, and they didn't pay a penny for it. So hopefully this inspired you as much as it inspired me. And for some of you, it may prove to be instructional if you have a student like this. Now, research is not always scientific research. There's research in English, and there's research in sociology, and there's research in psychology, and there's research in all aspects, visual arts, humanities, social sciences, natural sciences. So if you've got an inquiring mind, don't limit yourself just to thinking of research in a lab with scientific research, because there's lots of different types of research.
And now this week's interview with a special guest.
Okay, friends, I said we had a brand new interview, and it's with David Marcus. And I just want to tell you a little bit more about David, and I'll let him, you know, introduce himself more fully. But David is the author of several books. We're focusing on his book Acceptance today. But he's also the author of the book What It Takes to Pull Me Through. And it's a look at the secret lives of teenagers. He's been an educational writer and a foreign correspondent at U.S. News and World Report and the Boston Globe and the Miami Herald and the Dallas Morning News. He's also the co-winner of a Pulitzer Prize. He was a high school teacher for a while, but then he returned to journalism as a writer for Newsday. He's a graduate of Brown University, and he was also a Newman Fellow at Harvard University. He frequently speaks to schools, churches, and community groups about adolescence, education, and college admissions, and he's a regular listener of the Your College Bound Kid podcast. So I hope you enjoy my interview with David Marcus. Friends, you're in for a real treat today. I'm here with David Marcus, who's a journalist, author, and consultant who specializes in education. Welcome to the Your College Bound Kid podcast, David.
I really appreciate it. I'm a big fan, so it's an honor to be here.
Thank you. Thank you. So an interesting story, friend. So yeah, Dave reached out to me, said he's a regular podcast listener, enjoys the podcast, thinks he has something that could maybe be of interest to our guests. And I was saying to myself, why is his name so familiar? And we ended up having a pre-meeting, and I was still racking my brain. He ended up sending me a copy of his book, and then I remembered, oh, that's the book I read about a decade ago. I went back and looked at it. It was all marked up, and I've actually shared some things from your book, Acceptance, which we're going to be talking about in a minute, on the podcast. So I guess that's more of a story about my brain, my ticker failing as I am now that I'm in my 50s.
Okay, I could be insulted and say my book was not memorable to you, but I'll take your explanation.
No, but it's true. You'll see when we get to some key parts. I'm going to introduce some things that our regular listeners will be like, I remember when he said that. But for now, let's let our listeners know a little bit more about who you are, David. You want to share a little bit about your background?
Sure. My background only makes sense to me, but I'll tell you, I grew up in East Harlem, New York, and my parents were educators. And I'm going to tell you the names of two schools, but then I'm going to give you sort of a caveat or an exception. I went to a public high school that was not a very good high school. I ended up at Brown University, which was then not very competitive. It certainly has changed. And later I did a fellowship at Harvard. But the important thing is that a community college in Florida changed my life. That's where I was a young journalist. And at night, with electricians and with plumbers and with clerks, I studied Spanish at a community college. And that's where I learned Spanish. And that's where I was trained to become a foreign correspondent. So after being in Florida, after being in Texas as a reporter, I spent a decade in Mexico and then Bogota, Colombia, and then Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. But my first love was writing about education. And so I did return to that after being in Latin America. And I, along the way, I just sort of developed a specialty writing about K through 12, but especially about colleges. And so that led me to the book we're going to talk about. I can tell you about that in a minute, too.
Awesome. So, yeah, so a few things David didn't say, and he was part of an international reporting team that actually won a Pulitzer Prize. So that's noteworthy. And then he's written a couple books. He wrote a book about struggling teens called What It Takes to Pull Me Through. And then the book we're going to talk about today is the book Acceptance, which is about college admission. So let's talk about this book. Talk about the research you did that went into your book, and what motivated you to write the book in the first place?
Sure. So I did work for U.S. News Magazine, and I'll give you the disclaimer. I did not do the rankings of colleges. I have some strong kind of feelings about the ranking hospitals, ranking colleges. I think actually you, it might have been someone in your pod who said, you know, we don't rank churches. Yeah, so how are we going to rank college? Is good. I'm quoting you. See, you, I remember what you said and wrote. So anyway, I do have a lot of feelings about the silliness of ranking colleges, but U.S. News allowed me to go to admissions office, allowed me to go to campuses all over the country. And later I ended up at Newsday, a newspaper in the suburbs of New York. And an editor challenged me, a really interesting challenge, said, you are going to spend a year writing about the college admissions process, and I want you to find the best counselor at a school around here and just basically install yourself in that office and write about what happens in a year of the admissions process. So I put the word out all over the place, and people kept on saying, you got to go to Smitty, you got to go to Smitty. Smitty Graith-Smith was the counselor, the head of counseling at a school in Oyster Bay, New York, which is a good suburban school, not a great suburban school. It draws from very affluent, very wealthy people, as well as people in subsidized housing. And a lot of people whose parents didn't go to college, and also, of course, Ivy League grads and so forth. So I did my due diligence. I checked out counselors all over, and I ended up spending a year for a newspaper series in this school, watching the counselor. And then he said to me, as the series was coming out, he said, by the way, I'm retiring next year. And I said, I've got to come back here for a second year and do a book about this. It was so fascinating watching how he worked with people. And you do remember the book, because his motto is, it's not about the brand, it's about the fit. It's about finding the right college for a particular kid.
Yeah, and I always find books like this fascinating. I mean, going back to Jock Steinberg's book, The Gatekeepers, where, he sat in Wesleyan's admissions process for about 9 months and traced the life of five or six students. And then, of course, we've got Jeffrey Salingo's book, which came out a couple of years ago, tracing his year in the college admissions, where he sat in the admission process at Emory-Davidson and the University of Washington. I find that approach just very, very fascinating from a reporting standpoint. And I think it's a really good lens and a really good way to learn about college admission. So talk to us about what that experience was like, and how did you end up deciding to format your book the way that you did after that experience?
So my book is different from those two that you mentioned. I think I had the distinction of being the only person in America, the only person in the world who's ever written a book about a counselor, a school counselor. And that kind of sounds dry and dull, but it's really a book about several students going through the process from the valedictorian, who almost lives in the school. I mean, literally, she's there 18 hours a day, to the kind of jock that everybody dismisses as, you know, not a serious student and kind of ADHD and kind of lost. But what I want to do is I wanted to show parents, I want to show students that a great counselor, just like a great admissions person, can see the nuances of these students, can see the whole person. And what you learn is that the valedictorian had some incredible pressures from herself and from her first generation parents. And the jock, who everybody dismissed, was actually spending his Friday nights babysitting for cousins because a relative had had a drug problem, and he all of a sudden had these extra kids at his house he had to take care of. And I want to show how they, how this great counselor teased out the real students, the real personalities, so that college admissions offices would see them for all their possibilities. And so I basically lived in that office, and then I wrote this book, Acceptance, like a thriller, like a novel, like with really short chapters. And as you noted before, when we were talking off the air, really kind of fast moving and very visual, very visceral, because it is like a novel, except that everything's true in the book, except for I changed their names.
Yeah. And one thing I'll say is, and, you know, and Dave and I were talking about this before we got on, it may be 12 years old, but it could have been written today. I mean, if in fact, in a lot of ways, a lot of the things you talk about are more true even now than they were then. So what I'd love to do is have you comment on some of my favorite chapters from the book. And I went back and looked, and boy, my pen was marked up all these chapters. And the first one is chapter 3, which you just call BWRK. And I have to make a comment on this. You know, we do an admissions vernacular on every Thursday episode. And I've done BWRK before as an admissions vernacular. And I actually took it from your book. So there you go. So I've incorporated some of your book into our podcast, but I never gave you attribution until now.
I feel like it's now I can take my lawyer off your case now. So I love the way they counselors talk about students, and I spend a lot of time in admissions offices too. And so BWRK is shorthand that a few people use for bright, well-rounded kids. So you could argue that 30 years ago, colleges were looking for the well-rounded student who did well in humanities, did well in sciences and math. And now the schools are really looking for like an angle, like a defining thing. So to be a good all-around student, play a sport or two, and, you know, join a club is not enough for the most prestigious schools. And so it helps not just to be a BWRK. And so Smitty, this counselor, really tries to help kids. Now, I want to really emphasize this. He doesn't package them the way some private counselors do. He just wants them to be their real selves. But if they have an interest, they have a hobby, they have something they do, he wants them to really develop that. Now, I've done a lot of pro bono advising because it emerged from my giving speeches at high schools and synagogues and churches around the country. And then I did paid counseling. And I always tell students, I want you to be the real Felipe or the real Ryan or the real Ashley, who you are, not to fake it, but to make it who you really are, the best you. And that's what, so he wants people to go beyond being a BWRK, because colleges right now are getting so many bright, well-rounded kids. And you need, everybody kind of needs a story or an interest or a passion.
Yeah, no, it's really true. And a lot of times people nowadays will call it standard strong, but it's one of the things that leads to the most disillusionment I find is, why is it I've got a 1550 SAT, You know, I've got multivariable calculus and physics C, and I'm a 4.0. And I think my references are pretty good. I think I've been involved in a decent amount of things. And why am I not getting in my top choice schools? And people just don't realize this supply-demand issue. You know, I like to say people think they're in a hot tub or in a pool, and they think, oh, there's 100 people there, but it's really, they're really in an ocean, you know? They're in an ocean, and so colleges are looking for a well-rounded class, not necessarily a well-rounded student. So it's more a matter of, yeah, what piece of the puzzle can you come in to add to our whole tapestry?
Exactly.
And, you know, Elizabeth Heaton wrote a series a while ago called Who Gets Into Harvard. It was stood up a lot of controversy, but it was really good. And, she, you know, she talked about having a distinguishing excellence. And a lot of times colleges aren't always completely transparent on this because, you know, they don't want to discourage people. Like, you're sitting here talking in, to an audience and you know, and they ask that question and, you know, and someone says, hey, you know, I'm a good student. I've done pretty well, but I'm not the person that's won all these national awards. And, you know, and then the college may say, hey, you know, we take a wide range of different kinds of kids, which they do. And sometimes they're even asked the question, are you looking for the more well-rounded kid? Or are you looking for the more, there's a whole series of terms that have spun up, whether it's like angular or well lopsided, many other terms as well. And a lot of times the office, the admission office says, well, we want both. And what they're really kind of saying is we want you to be who you are. So don't pretend you're somebody different than who you are because we want your authentic self. But a lot of times what they don't tell you, if it's the more selective schools, there's not a lot of spots for people that don't have something unique that they're bringing that makes them a standout in our applicant pool. And so I really appreciated you, you know, drawing attention to that, you know, in this book. And so how did your conversations with Smitty shape up around this? Was he sharing you with you basically that, hey, I'm finding those kids get waitlisted and they're disillusioned, or how did that go?
Yeah, well, I'll actually, you know, Smitty was frank with kids and said, you know, starting now, remember, a good counselor who has some capacity, some, you know, some is not overloaded, will start working with these kids in ninth grade, not to talk about colleges, but just to make sure that they really delve into interests and so forth. And so he would talk to kids starting in ninth grade about just how to take advantage of high school. And, you know, I will tell you as a dad, my youngest is a baseball player, and I have watched the teams that he has played against. And the best teams do not have kind of just good all-around players. They have somebody who's really versatile, really, I mean, really talented at catching, and they have a couple really good pitchers, and they have somebody who's just amazing in right field. And they've got a first baseman who's got this incredible arm to reach out and get things and reflexes. And the colleges are trying to put together a baseball team, not of nine, but of 900 or 9,000. And they want the oboe player, and they want the Latin enthusiast, and they want the bird watcher. And, you know, people have come up to me after I speak at schools, and they've told me amazing stories. I've just had incredible encounters. And then I worked with a kid, helped a kid not too long ago, who the parents and the kid were a little bit despondent. He doesn't have any special things. He's just a good, bright, when, you know, rounded, well-rounded kid. And then we talked. And then sort of offhand, when the parents were leaving, the mom said, ah, you know, like, I wish he like had spent his time productively. He's in 11th grade and, you know, he could have done this. And just, he's like, he's selling sneakers in his spare time. What? He's selling sneakers in his spare time. Now, you just mentioned this in a podcast the other day. You were talking about Air Jordans that cost $900. You were talking about that as, to sure. sort of compare it to colleges. But I said, well, hold on a second. So here's a kid who got up at 4 a.m. It was a good student, wasn't always the most motivated student, but it's a really good student. But 4 a.m, first in line to get the Air Jordans or whatever sneakers were on sale, or hustling them online to get them and selling them and buying them, selling and keeping track of them spreadsheets. And I helped him. I didn't do anything except for just say, there's your story, there's your essay. I helped him parlay that into some good college admissions, because he wasn't just like a kid kind of goofing off. He was an entrepreneur at age 14, 15, 16, 17. And so that's what I mean. So that was his angle, was that he bought and sold sneakers. And his essay was powerful because you've talked about this. It was not a brag. It was not a humble brag. It was just humble. He talked about how he'd bought these sneakers and he found out when he tried to sell them that the stitching was all wrong and they were totally fakes. And he just got hammered on money. He got ripped off. And he had to make an ethical dilemma. You know, am I going to resell these and rip somebody off or just take the loss? He took the loss. There it is. So it's a kid who he did not win the most prestigious, scholarship in science research, but he sold sneakers.
No. There's a lot of different approaches you can take. And one thing I like to share with families is if we accept that there's approximately 2,400 four-year accredited, not-profit, bachelor's-granting institutions out there, if people can get off of just looking at to what I call the one percenters, the 25 schools, like, do you think maybe 10% of those schools are good? If you can broaden your list and look at two and accept that there's 250 good schools out of that 2,500, or even if you want to look at 5%, 125, those are the kids that do extremely well. But it's this fixation with the 1% that really ends up frustrating a lot of people. The kids I find that are the most satisfied, they accept the fact that there are more good schools than 25 out there, or even 50, and they broaden that list, and they have an absolutely really pleasant college search process. And so that's my biggest challenge. You know, most of the times when people talk to me about this, they want to know what's the angle for me to get one of those spots. Not telling you not to apply, but I don't want you to define your success as whether or not you get one of those spots, because, you know, most people don't play sports and say, well, I'm only going to see myself as a success if I get an Olympic medal.
Yeah.
They don't do that. But yet in college admissions, they've created this bar that is ridiculously high. And a lot of it's not quite honest because they really just don't realize how much competition is out there in the world or how strong the other applicants are. There's a tendency to say, oh, 11% admit rate, that's fine, I'll be the 11%. And you may, but that other 89% is exceptionally strong as well. And respecting the competition should lead to, you know, to building a balanced list. But let's go to your next point, because in some ways this similar to this one, but slight nuance different. So chapter 4 is entitled When Everyone is Special, No One is Special. Tell us about that.
This does play off the previous chapter in some ways, but I try to focus each chapter on a kid and a kid's challenge, a kid's dilemma, after talking to the kid and the parents and Smitty, the counselor. So this one is about a kid I call Lee. Again, these are real kids, real things. And Lee had very high SAT scores. Very high test scores and really good grades in a lot of AP courses. And on Saturdays, he spent hours studying Korean, not because he wanted to, but because his parents made him study Korean. And yet he felt that was the chapter name. He felt when everyone is special, no one's special. Here he has all this great stuff going on, but how is he ever going to get into these prestigious colleges where, frankly, his parents were fixated. They really want him to get into these. And there's a kind of funny aside that this is like something I would want to do as a parent, but I'd never have the guts to. His parents basically bribed him, like, if you get 50 points, you get higher on the SAT, you can get a used minivan, or you can get a used sedan, or you can get a brand new, you can get a Tesla if you get a perfect test score. Now, first of all, I don't think I have the wherewithal to do that, but the striver parent in me kind of wishes I had the guts to do that. But anyway, Lee was Smitty, the counselor, looked at Lee and said, oh, you know, another one of these kids who has so much pressure on himself and so much pressure from parents, and he, you know, how is he special? And the more they talked, it came out that Lee was really wrestling with something that made him a very interesting person, which was he was wrestling with the pressure his parents put on him and his culture put on him. But also, he had grown up religious, and he was having doubts about what he learned in religion school and what he'd been taught and what he'd been spoon-fed. And it made him a much more complex and interesting person, and a person who was who would be appealing, frankly, to a college where you're supposed to go and debate and doubt and learn and be curious. And so Smitty sort of helped tease that out of him, and he wrote what were ultimately really compelling essays, and Smitty wrote him really compelling recommendations about the fact that he was dealing with these things that, you know, a lot of teenagers start to deal with but don't really deal with. And he ultimately, I mean, I'll tell you, he got into NYU, which was his first choice, into the Stern, into a great business program there. And partly I think it's because he was special, but he wasn't special on paper in his grades and his APs and his scores. He was special because of what was in his mind and in his intellect.
Yeah, I think sometimes people underestimate how much colleges are looking for interesting and unique kids. And anytime you had opportunity to be interesting, unique, you have a potential to pop.
Friends, this concludes the first part of our three-part interview. I hope you'll join us next week for part two of three.
On Thursday's episode, Julia is my co-pilot, and we will be discussing an article in the Chronicle of Education entitled "A Profession on the Edge: Why Admission Officers Are Wearing Down, Burning Out, and Leaving a Profession They Once Loved." We've never addressed this topic before. It's an article by Eric Hoover. Our SpeakPipe question comes from an American living abroad, Ali in Europe. And she wants to know, how can you avoid being unduly influenced by an older sibling's positive experience at a university? And now your second child is seeing everything through the prism of the other university. How can you avoid that? Is that good? Is that bad? So Lisa and I will talk about that. Brand new interview, but not a brand new person. Gus Resendez. Remember Gus? He did an interview about avoiding the potholes in athletic recruiting about 6 months ago. We got tremendous feedback on that. Well, Gus is back. He has a great perspective on the pros and cons of attending a co-op centered university, having done that himself. And so we do a deep dive into this. It'll be a three-parter that will air three Thursdays in a row. And our spotlight will be part two of Sylvia Borgo doing a deep dive into the Semester at Sea Study Abroad program. Friends, I know you often hear me say that college is a match to be made and not a prize to be won. But what does that mean? Well, when college is a prize to be won, all you care about is going to the most selective school. All you care about is going to the most prestigious school. It's very important to you that you are celebrated amongst peer and families for getting in a highly selective school, because that was a goal, to recognition. You have a prize mentality. I won, now give me my accolades. But when you have a match mentality, it's very different. First of all, you put the time in to really think through what you want in a college. You've assessed the colleges in multiple ways that go beyond selectivity. You're comfortable in your own skin. Now, you still might end up attending an extremely prestigious college. It might even be the most prestigious college on your list. But you approached it not about the prestige and the selectivity, but about the match. You've thought through things like, is the school an academic match? Which involves all kinds of things. It refers to things like, will it be strong in my area of interest? Will the students I'm around be at the academic level I want to be at? Things like class size and academic resources, whether it's support services or other resources, teaching style. And that's just the academic match. I won't go into detail now about this, but you've looked at the social match, the emotional match, and the financial match. That's what we mean. And so shout out to Frank Sachs, the former president of NACAC, who coined the term, college is a match to be made
and not a prize to be won. See you on Thursday, friends.
And that's our show. A big thank you to you, our listeners, for tuning in this week. If you find this podcast helpful, please follow us and you'll get every single episode as soon as it is released. If you're interested, there are a few ways you can really support our podcast. You can click the share button and send it to your friends and acquaintances. You can help us pay our staff and our expenses by donating on our website. You can write a review for us on Apple or Spotify. I'm the producer of the podcast, but we have a fantastic team of 15. Shout out to our co-host, Dr. Lisa Ruff, Dr. David Williams, Linda Depker, Susan Tree, Vince Garcia, and Julia Esquivel. And to our substitute co-host, Sylvia Borgo. Our sensational sound engineer is Nemanja Matvich. Our amazing music is from Victor Allen Weeks. Marketing designs are from Kimberly Blass. Lily Parikh manages our Instagram. Our image editor is Talha Khan. Joyce Ducker does our website episode updates. And our webmaster is Stylianos Dimitriou. And if you want to have a coaching session with Lisa, Linda, or me, just text me at 404-664-4340. If you have a question you want us to answer, or if you have a recommended resource or article you think we should discuss, just send it to questions@yourcollegeboundkid.com. Our favorite method is for you to record your own voice at speakpipe.com/YCBK. By the way, check out our website, where you'll find lots of content that is not on any podcast app. Our website is yourcollegeboundkid.com. If you want to learn about other hot admissions topics, follow us on Twitter at YCBK Podcast. We think of you as our listening family, and we look forward to meeting again with you every single Monday and Thursday.